Hi, this is Matt Baker. Welcome to episode 4 in my series on the family tree of Christian denominations. Last time we reached the Protestant section of the tree and looked at the Lutheran, Anglican, and Reformed branches, all of which resulted in new state-level churches throughout Europe. In today's video, we're therefore going to switch gears and start to look at some of the more radical groups that emerged out of the Reformation. In particular, we'll be looking at the Anabaptists, the Brethren, and the Quakers, which together are often called the peace churches because they are all pacifist. I'll also be talking about the Puritans and the situation in the early American colonies, as well as some important changes that I've made to the overall chart. Originally, I had planned to cover the Baptists in this episode as well. Note that the Baptists are different from the Anabaptists. However, I'm now going to cover them in more detail in episode 5, alongside the Methodists. Altogether, this series will likely have 7 episodes, so if at the end of this video you're left wondering why I didn't mention a particular denomination, well, just remember that there's more episodes to come. You can check the description to see what's available so far. Also, as I mentioned last time, the full chart, once completed, will be available as a poster. But if you're watching this in early 2023, it's not ready yet, because I'm still making changes as I go. Again, check the description box for the details. So speaking of changes, let me show you a few things I've done since last time. First of all, I've added some infographics at the top. On the left, I have the 10 largest Christian communions worldwide. Basically, each church icon represents 10 million members. So, as you probably know, the Catholic Church is by far the largest Christian group in the world, with around 1.35 billion members. Second is the Eastern Orthodox Church, with 200 million. With one exception, the rest of the list is all Protestant. So coming in at number 3 is the Anglican Communion, followed by the Reformed Churches, the Methodists, and the Lutheran World Federation. All of these groups have around 80 million members. We then have the Assemblies of God, which is a Pentecostal denomination that I've not yet talked about. We probably won't get to them until episode 7. Then we have the Oriental Orthodox Churches. Remember, these are different from the Eastern Orthodox Churches. We talked about them in episode 1, and they include the Coptic Church and the Ethiopian Church. Finally, we have the Baptist World Alliance with around 48 million members, and the Seventh-day Adventists with 22 million. I'll be talking about the Baptists in episode 5 and the Adventists in episode 6. On the right-hand side of the chart, I've added this map showing the dominant type of Christianity by country. So, first of all, note that on this map, green represents any type of Protestant, whereas yellow is Catholic, red is Eastern Orthodox, and purple is Oriental Orthodox. The gray areas are those countries where Christianity is very much in the minority, representing less than 10% of the total population. Okay, on the main chart, I've made some changes as well. For example, once again, I've had to fix the Georgian Orthodox Church. I initially had it stemming from Russia, and then from Constantinople. However, it was actually granted independence from Antioch, so I've added a line to make that clear. I've also added 2 extra groups stemming from the Catholic Church, but separate from the Protestants. The first is the Philippine Independent Church, which broke away in 1902 and is now in communion, among others, with the Anglicans. That's why they are colored purple. Note that I've also changed the Union of Utrecht Catholics to be purple as well, because they too are in communion with the Anglicans. The second edition is SSPX, which stands for the Society of St. Pius X. Their status is kind of up in the air. They are different from the Sedevacantists because they do not claim that the current pope is illegitimate. However, in 1988, their leader, Archbishop Marcel Lefebvre, consecrated several new priests without the pope's permission, creating a controversy that is yet to be resolved. Over here, beneath the Armenian church, I've added a few medieval groups that have come up in the comments quite a bit, namely the Paulicians, Bogomils, and Cathars. I'll explain who they are and why I decided to add them to the chart, not in today's episode, but in episode 5, when I talk about the Baptists. So, I'm going to keep you in a bit of suspense for now. However, another medieval group, the Lollards, I've added over here. They were a proto-Protestant group inspired by the early English Bible translator John Wycliffe. So, I felt that they deserved to be included alongside the Waldensians and the Hussites, who also fit under the category of Protestants before Protestants. Let's now move over to the Anglican section. Note that I've added the Scottish Episcopal Church alongside the Church of Scotland. For a while during the 1500s and 1600s, it was unclear which one of these would end up being the state Church of Scotland. In the end, Presbyterianism won out. However, I decided to show the Scottish Episcopal Church on the chart as well, due to its connection to the Episcopal Church in the US. You see, when the American colonies broke away from Great Britain, their bishops could no longer be consecrated by the Church of England, because that would require taking an oath of allegiance to the king. So in order to get around this, they were consecrated by the Scottish Episcopal Church instead. By this point, the Scottish Episcopal Church was independent from the Church of England and was not the state church in Scotland. Therefore, no oath to the king was needed. Now, on to the Reformed section. Last time, I failed to mention the two main Reformed denominations in the US. The oldest one is the Reformed Church in America, which started off as a branch of the Dutch Reformed Church. Most of its members merged with a Lutheran synod in 1934 to form the ENR Church, which then went on to become part of the United Church of Christ. However, some of those in the Reformed Church in America remained separate and kept the name, and therefore that church still exists to this day. In addition to this, the Christian Reformed Church had previously broke away from them in 1857, and that church still exists too. When it comes to the Presbyterian part of this section, I decided to add the two largest Presbyterian churches in Korea, as they are the main churches in that country, and together they represent the largest group of Presbyterians in the world. Originally, they were a single church, but they split up in 1959. The original church was planted by American Presbyterians, so I showed the connection back to them as well. Okay, with that out of the way, we can now focus on the main topic for today, the Anabaptists and the Quakers. These two groups are very different from the Lutherans, Anglicans, and Reformed that we discussed last time. You see, when the Reformation occurred in places like Germany, England, and Switzerland, it's not as if all the Catholic churches in those places were shut down and new Lutheran, Anglican, and Reformed churches were established. No, instead, most of the Catholic churches in those places simply switched to become Lutheran, Anglican, or Reformed churches. And in many cases, the new type of Christianity was established as the state-sponsored religion. So in other words, the Lutheran, Anglican, and Reformed churches weren't actually new churches. They were simply old churches that changed their theology, and in some cases their practices, but usually only a little bit and slowly over time. In contrast, all of the groups that we're going to discuss from this point forward were actually new groups, groups that were radically different from the Catholic Church, not only in theology, but also in practice. When it comes to the Anabaptists, one of the practices that they were most concerned with was baptism. In the Catholic Church, as well as in the Lutheran, Anglican, and Reformed churches, Christians are usually baptized as infants. The Anabaptists thought this was unbiblical because infants are not able to understand what is happening or to make a conscious commitment to follow Jesus. Instead, they felt that people should only be baptized once they were old enough to understand and believe and make the decision for themselves. The initial Anabaptists therefore baptized themselves again, which is why they ended up being called Anabaptists, meaning re-baptizers. However, the original Anabaptists simply called themselves Brethren. The movement started in Switzerland, so the term Swiss Brethren is also sometimes used for these initial Anabaptists. One of their early leaders was a man named Menno Simons. he helped spread Anabaptist ideas in the Dutch Republic, and hence, the largest branch of the Anabaptists eventually became known as the Mennonites. However, in 1693, there was a schism in which some of the Mennonites left to follow a man named Jacob Amman. From that point forward, those who broke off became known as the Amish. There is a third main group as well, known as the Hutterites, named after Jacob Hutter, who helped spread Anabaptist ideas to Austria and further east. Now these days, all three of the original Anabaptist groups are mostly associated with simple living, old-fashioned clothes, and a rejection of modern technology. However, it is important to note that when it comes to the rejection of technology, there is actually a wide range of practices among Anabaptists today. Generally speaking, it's really only the Amish who reject almost all modern technology. For example, they are well known for still using the horse and buggy instead of cars. But even among the Amish, there is at least one group, the Beachy Amish, who, for example, will use the internet, albeit in a restricted way. The Hutterites are the next most traditional group, but they tend to allow more colorful clothing, and in some cases even use cell phones. And the Mennonites? Well, aside from the Old Order Mennonites, who are very much in the minority, most Mennonites no longer have any extreme restrictions on the use of technology. Conservative Mennonites still wear traditional clothing, but most Mennonites are actually indistinguishable from the average American. If you want to learn more about the Mennonites, I suggest you check out today's Ready to Harvest video, which I'll link to in the description. Ready to Harvest, hosted by Joshua, is all about the differences between Christian denominations, and he's almost at 100,000 subscribers. So if you haven't yet subscribed, I highly recommend that you do so. Now, I should point out that although the Anabaptists first emerged in Europe, many of them ended up migrating to North America. This is because initially, North America offered more freedom when it came to what religion a person could follow. However, some moved east towards Poland and then settled in Russia in the late 1700s. While there, they were influenced by the radical Pietists, whom we'll be discussing next, and therefore they took the name Mennonite Brethren. Many of them ended up immigrating to North America as well, and kept that name, which distinguishes them from the other American Mennonites, who were originally split into two main conferences, but who merged in 2002 to form the Mennonite Church USA. Now, before I get to the Pietists, I want to point out two Anabaptist groups that emerged much later than the original three. These are the Apostolic Christian Church, established in 1832 by a man named Samuel Froelich, and the Bruderhof, established in 1920 by Eberhard Arnold. In both these cases, the founders were inspired by the earlier Anabaptist groups, but rather than join them, they founded new groups. The Bruderhof, like most of the Amish and Hutterites, live communally, whereas the Apostolic Christian Church, like most Mennonites, do not. Okay, I now want to talk about Pietism, which is based on the word pious, meaning a strong devotion to one's religion. Unlike the Anabaptists, who emerged early on in the Reformation, the radical Pietists emerged more than a century later, in the late 1600s and early 1700s. By this point, Lutheranism was firmly established in many areas of Europe. But some Germans and Scandinavians felt that the Reformation hadn't gone far enough. They wanted to go beyond mere discussions about theology and focus more on a religion of the heart. Some Pietists wanted to change things from within the established churches, but others were more radical and ended up establishing new groups instead. One of these more radical Pietists was a man named Alexander Mack from Schwarzenau, Germany. He founded the Schwarzenau Brethren, also known as the German Baptists or Dunkers. The main denomination to come out of that movement was the Church of the Brethren. Note that although the Church of the Brethren emerged out of the Pietist movement and is often classified under the term Brethren, it was also heavily influenced by Anabaptism, and therefore is usually considered to fit under that umbrella as well. Another Anabaptist church that falls under the Brethren category is the River Brethren, founded by a former Mennonite. They are more traditional, like the Old Order Mennonites, and exist in far fewer numbers. Now, I want to point out that the term Brethren can be quite confusing, because there are several other totally unrelated churches that also use this same term, the most notable being the Plymouth Brethren. I'll discuss them in a future episode, but for now, just note that they are unrelated to the Anabaptist Brethren. I also want to point out a few churches that developed out of Pietism but are not associated with the Anabaptists, and are thus not peace churches. These include the Evangelical Church of America and the Evangelical Covenant Church. Both of these denominations emerged out of the Scandinavian free churches. Free churches being those that were not part of the state-sponsored churches, such as the Church of Sweden, Church of Norway, etc. Okay, let's now talk about the Quakers. They are similar to Anabaptists in that they are pacifists, but they trace their origins to England instead of to continental Europe, and never did live in communal settings. As we learned last time, the Church of England was established in 1534 as the new state church. However, like in other areas, there were some in England that felt that the Reformation hadn't gone far enough. In England, these people became known as the Puritans. Most of the Puritans wanted to change the church from within, such as Oliver Cromwell, but there were some who wanted to separate and form new denominations. These more extreme reformers became known as English Separatists. Initially, there were many different types of English Separatists. The Quakers were just one of them, as were the Baptists, which we'll be discussing next time. Some of the other groups were the Diggers, the Enthusiasts, the Ranters, the Seekers, and my personal favorite, the Muggletonians. All of these movements have since died out, but the Quakers and Baptists continue to this day. The main founder of Quakerism was a man named George Fox. When he was brought before the courts on charges of blasphemy, he told those gathered that they should tremble or quake at God's word, probably a reference to Isaiah 66 verse 2, which says, "But this is the one to whom I will look, to the humble and contrite in spirit, who trembles at my word." This is why the followers of George Fox became known as Quakers, even though their official name is the Religious Society of Friends. One of the distinct aspects of Quakerism is their emphasis on the inner light, or the ability of every person to experience God from within. This is why traditional Quaker meetings are usually unplanned and involve a lot of silence, so that each person can listen carefully to God's voice within themselves. Lucky for the Quakers and other English separatists, the origins of their movements coincided with the settling of the Americas. This allowed many of these controversial groups to avoid persecution by simply moving far, far away. Although that didn't always work either, and the Quakers ended up being persecuted in America as well. As I mentioned last time, among the first English separatists who came to America in the 1600s were the Congregationalists, who fit under the Reformed branch of Christianity. They were the dominant group in New England, and thus Congregationalism became the state religion in most of the New England states, including Massachusetts and Connecticut. One early exception to this was Rhode Island, which was established by Roger Williams, who founded the first Baptist church in America there. We'll talk more about him next time, but for now, I want to focus instead on the middle colonies, just south of New England. This area was originally controlled by the Dutch. In 1657, a group of settlers living in what is today Flushing, Queens, wrote a letter to the governor asking that Quakers be allowed to worship there. In fact, they also wanted religious freedom to extend to all Christian groups, as well as to Jews and Muslims. Their request was denied, but the letter, known as the Flushing Remonstrance, ended up setting the stage for what would become the First Amendment of the U.S. Constitution, the one that separates church and state and allows for the freedom of religion. Interestingly, one of the individuals who signed the Flushing document was William Thorne, who happens to be one of my wife's direct ancestors. My wife is Jewish on her father's side and Quaker on her mother's side. Another step on the path towards religious freedom in America was the founding of Pennsylvania in 1681. It was founded by a Quaker named William Penn, who allowed people from all religious groups to come and settle in his colony. So not only did Quakers settle there, but also Anabaptist groups like the Mennonites and the Amish. However, in 1827, the Quakers experienced a major schism, with those following a man named Elias Hicks becoming known as the Hicksites. Hicks was an early abolitionist and was involved in the Underground Railroad, which helped black slaves to escape to the North. Today, the descendants of the Hicksites are those who belong to the Friends General Conference, the most liberal of the three main Quaker groups. The non-Hicksites eventually split into the Wilburites and the Gurneyites, with the Wilburites basically being slightly more conservative versions of the Hicksites, and the Gurneyites going in a totally new direction. Basically, the Gurneyites ended up becoming like other churches in America, with planned services, pastors, and more mainstream Christian beliefs. Most of the Gurneyite descendants today belong to the Friends United Meeting, although some belong to the smaller, more conservative, Evangelical Friends Church. Now, before I go, I can't really bring up Quakers without addressing this. I think most people assume that Quaker Oats was a company started by Quakers. Well, this isn't actually true. The founder of the company simply named his product Quaker Oats because by then Quakers were associated with integrity and honesty, and he wanted to be associated with those traits as well. If you want to associate actual Quakers with a product, that product should be chocolate, not oats. All three of the big British chocolate companies that started in the 1800s, Cadbury's, Roundtree's, and Fry's, were all founded by Quakers. Okay, so that was a look at the Anabaptists and Quakers. Next episode, which should be ready in about 3 weeks, we'll focus primarily on the Baptists and the Methodists. And then further out, I'll be covering the Mormons, Adventists, Pentecostals, and much, much more. So be sure to subscribe and click the bell so you don't miss out on those. Thanks for watching.